Welcome back to the series Airtable for Newbies. In this video, I am breaking down the importance of using apps within your Airtable database. So if you have any questions about how to install an app, what apps are, or how they even apply to your billing, this is the video for you because we are diving into all of it. So if that's of interest, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth. I am the owner at Gap Consulting, and it's my mission to help you save up to 20 hours of your time every week thanks to no-code tools. Yes, even if you are not a paying client of mine, I am making it my mission to help you in that way. So check out this channel if you haven't already. Make sure you've subscribed so that you can get up-to-date information about the power of no-code and leveraging no-code automation. Specifically, when you are ready to take the next step and jump into no-code and automation, I welcome you to check out my free webinar training that's going to teach you how to think programmatically so that you can start building these automations from scratch to run those repetitive tasks for you in the background while you focus on the important stuff. Sign up for that at garethpronovost.com/webinar-registration, and I will send that directly to you. But without further ado, let's hop on into the heart of this video and outline what are Airtable apps. Well, in short, an app in Airtable is a thing that you can install into your database so that you can perform some additional or enhanced functionality. And these apps run the gamut of different possibilities. Most of them help with data visualization, but a lot of them are doing deeper things than that. And for the more advanced users, we even get into scripting, where you can use some JavaScript to write a little snip of code to perform some stuff for you. But this channel focuses more on the no-code side of things, and this is a video for newbies, so we are not going to jump all into scripting right here. Instead, I'm going to show you how to install and think about the apps. But before we get to that, I have to talk about pricing and what is allotted to you based on the pricing plan that you are on within Airtable. Now, I do want to preface and say that while I'm recording this at the end of January 2022, the pricing model for Airtable is currently in flux. They have been transparent about the fact that they are making changes to this. I don't want to speak to the changes just in case something changes on the changes before they actually publish. So what I am quoting and referencing here is the live version as of today's date. But if you're watching this in February, there's a great chance that this has already changed. So you'll need to make sure to do your own research to see what's available for your plan. Right here, I've got this broken down into free, plus, and pro. Enterprise is another beast of its own. So we're gonna scroll on down and get specifically to the apps section here. And you see that all of the apps, with the exception of scripting, are available only on that third and fourth tier, pro and enterprise. Now, as I've said, the pricing changes that are coming up are going to turn all of this on its head. It's rumored that there may be some apps available in limited quantities for lower tiered plans. And there also may be some limits to the number of apps that we can install based on the plan that we're on. Again, do your own research once those pricing changes are finalized and check out the pricing page for Airtable.com. But as it stands right now, if you're on that pro plan, you have that ability to install apps directly into your base. So let's talk about why we would want to do that, how we would do that, and everything that's involved with that. Now, it probably won't come as a surprise that the first thing we have to do in our case is actually outline an example problem. So let's go ahead and flip on into my Airtable base, and we're going to look at a specific problem that's actually come up a couple of times this week with the clients I've been working with. So here I have three main tables. I've got clients, and I've just named them the first four letters of the Greek alphabet. Don't read into that. And we've got the work units here, which I'll explain in a minute, but the general idea here is that a certain client might take more resources, more time, because of the complexity of their specific needs and problems that we're working on with them. On my second table, I have a team. And here I'm listing out my different team members: Hank, Dagny, Francisco, and Ragnar. And you'll notice that everyone has a role assigned, either manager or consultant. And then of course, we're linking here to workload as well. Looking at workload, this is where we're breaking down the different folks working on the different projects. So for example, in my first record here, you'll see that this links to my first client and to one of my team members who is a manager. And so this is actually called a junction table. I've spoken about these at length in numerous videos. This is something you cannot escape from if you are trying to become an Airtable expert or really strengthen your skills in Airtable. So do check out junction tables. But what I'm doing here is I'm assigning a team member to a specific client, and I want to pull in the value of the effort that that team member has to contribute for that instance. So let's jump into this a little bit more, because of course I'm able to look up this work unit, right? This is a lookup field that's looking at the work unit that I've assigned to the client, but that may or may not be the actual work unit. Because imagine this scenario, we've got managers and consultants. Maybe our consultants are doing 2 times the work as the manager on any particular project, meaning that a manager can work on twice as many projects at a time because of course their attentions are split and the depth that they need to go into is different than that of the consultant. And this is typical in so many different industries and services, because as you have different roles within your organization, of course people's responsibilities are going to be markedly different in terms of what they're contributing to every specific project or service. So in this case, a manager is going to take that actual work unit, but the consultant in this case is going to have that multiplied by 2. So this is a simple nested if statement. Don't let this overwhelm you if you're new to formulas, but in short, what I'm doing is I'm looking to see what the role of this particular team member is. If it is manager, then I'm going to just take the work unit lookup value at face value. But if it is that this person is a consultant, then I'm going to take that work unit value and multiply it by 2, because I'm aware of the fact that consultants have to put in twice the effort per project that we've assigned from that value based on the client unit. So if we take a look at this going down the line, you'll see that yes, in this case, Hank, the manager, the work unit here is 1 for this particular client, and that's the actual for Hank. But as we look at Francisco, the consultant, his work unit is 2. Here we have a work unit from this client of the value 2. For the manager, it stays the same. For the consultant, again, it's multiplied by 2. So it's this work unit actual that I want to take and observe and understand, how is my team's effort split? I've got my team, am I overloading them with work right now? Who has room on their plate to take on a new project and who doesn't? Let's use an app for this, because it's really simple for us to build a quick app that's gonna give us high level data visualization and allow us to gain this insight without having to do a lot of crazy math on the back end. Essentially, what we want is a summation tool that's looking at our data and summing it based on the team member and saying, I know that Francisco has 2 work units for this particular project, and in this case, he has 6 work units for this particular project for a total of 8. How do we build it? I am going to open up my apps here on the side, and before I make a selection, I really want to talk to you quickly about the different ways that you can navigate the apps and what is in store for you here. There is the featured apps on the first tab here, and this is by default what's going to show up. So if you want to explore the apps or look at the page designer or go a little deeper into scripting, all of that lives right here. If we look at the next tab over, this is apps by Airtable. Something to note is that third-party developers can contribute apps to the marketplace. And this is really cool. It opens up what we can do inside of Airtable, but a word of caution, you should definitely make sure to read the fine print, because this is going to be linking in with a third-party tool. So make sure that you know what kind of data privacy and all of that that third party has put into place to protect your information. I tend to err on the side of caution, especially with client work, because I don't want to rely on third-party tools unless I absolutely have to. So I stay in the Airtable environment and in the apps offered by Airtable as much as possible, because I'm already confident that Airtable can deliver a high standard of privacy. Now, if you want to go deeper though, there are the all apps option here, and you can look at some scripts or even build your own custom app if you are so inclined. But in my case, I am going to go back to the featured tab here and I am going to select the Pivot Table app. Now, most apps are going to work the exact same as this. They'll often have a little explanation video. For some reason, this one's currently disabled. Once you add the app though, it is going to do all the heavy lifting for you in the background, but there are some things that you will need to set up every single time. In most cases, and in this case, the first thing we're asked is to make sure that we're pointed to a specific table. This is very common when setting up any app, that you have to look at data living in one table. So as a quick timeout here, this reiterates why we have to always work first on the right data structure before we can go adding all the bells and whistles. If I hadn't properly built out my workload table already, it wouldn't matter either way because I wouldn't be able to visualize that data. But I have built it. So I'm looking at that table, that's where this information lives. And if you have multiple views, for example, if you filtered out some records that you don't want included in your particular app summary, well then, use that particular view that has filtered that data out and make that selection here. In my case, I just have the one view, so I'll pop that in. And now we have to get into the nuance for the particular app that we've installed. In this case, Pivot Table. So how am I going to be grouping this data? Well, of course, I want to see information based on the team members. So I'm imagining that I have my team members listed by row, and so I'll make that selection here. Now, as soon as I do that, you see that that information does pop in here, and I'm getting some sort of information, some data summation here that I haven't yet tweaked. Now, if I look at it, what it's summarizing by default, is a count. So yes, Dagny, Francisco, Hank, and Ragnar, they each appear twice in the particular table workload and in the particular view, grid view, that I've assigned here. But I don't care how many times they appear there. I care about the value. What's that work unit? And I want to sum it across all of the instances. So I am going to go by a specific field, not a count. And I'm going to pick that field, in this case, my work unit actual field, and I have to choose the summary type, and in my case, that will be a summation. Once I've done this, I'm almost all the way there, but you can see that I've got the right values coming in. If we think back, Francisco had 2 units in one project, 6 on another, and here we have 8 showing up for him, so we're on the right track. The last piece that I want to add here is actually a column grouping as well. I want to see this broken out by role. So when I make that selection, you'll notice that I have new columns where I have my consultant data showing up in one place, my manager data showing up in the next column, and then a sum of all of those values regardless of role. So I'm going to click done and zoom out of this now. And now my app lives here on the side, and this will always show me a current reflection of what's happening. So let's say, for example, that Ragnar got pulled from this particular project as a consultant. We see that the work unit actual for this particular project is 4 for a consultant role. So if I pull Ragnar out and I add another consultant, Francisco, we see that the data here on my pivot table is instantly updating. Francisco has now gone from having 8 work units assigned to 12. So obviously he is overloaded now as compared to Ragnar. And that's something that the pivot table is making readily available to us right then and there. Now, as one final thought, I do want to say that in the upcoming video for this series, we are going to be looking at Airtable interfaces. And historically, we didn't have interfaces to fall back on. Interfaces are a newer feature of Airtable that have only just released in the last quarter or so. So the reason I want to bring this up is that interfaces are actually my preferred tool for any kind of charts and graphs and summary and things of that nature. It used to be that we had to rely only on the apps, and so a lot of the apps that I used to build with for clients inside of Airtable, charts or searches or org charts, all of this I feel shows up better now in the Airtable interface. So I do want to point that out, that if you are struggling to really visualize your data, there are some instances where the apps I think still make the best choice, but I think there are many more instances where you would prefer to have an interactive dashboard where you can change filters on the fly and instantly be shown the new version of the data, the new summations, the new whatever you've built. So be sure to check out our upcoming video, Airtable Interfaces for Newbies, and I will see you in the next one.
As always, I hope you found that to be extremely helpful. If you did and you'd like to learn more, swing by our website and see how we can help. We offer a free Airtable crash course that will help you level up in Airtable quickly, and we also have some paid services, including hourly consultations with our experts. We have some online courses and a group coaching program. And for advanced needs, we can build a bespoke solution for you from scratch. So swing on by, and I look forward to connecting with you soon.